Good evening, respected chairpersons and dear friends. This is not a very usual topic. When Shiva called me to give this talk, I started recollecting what all probably we have changed our decision during the structural intervention. It turned out to be a fairly interesting topic. So I would classify where we have changed in our decision, for example, not closing AST, not closing a PDA, not closing a VST, in some of these cases, classify into shunt lesions, obstructive lesions, and a prefrontal, very occasionally. The first and foremost in the hemodynamic assessment, any of the structural intervention is that we cannot compromise on a couple of things. One is you have to have a proper hardware, and most importantly, more than that, is you have to, on the cath table, please ensure when you are doing the procedures like which I'm going to delve in future slides, ensure that you have two pressure lines. Most of the times we try to compromise just managing the whole cath data on the single pressure line. It is not going to work. And you have to zero it properly, and you have to make sure that it is balanced properly, and you have to have other things like oximetry and other data for the... So in shunt lesions, these are all very standard, simple cases where we have to probably change our decisions. The standard pulmonary artery calculation, resistance, keep up a QS, the systemic pressure. So many often we don't put the arterial line, but it is mandatory beforehand, before taking any particular patient, that you have to, for example, 45-year-old man or 50-year-old man with a severe hypertension or diabetic, or where we suspect some problem with the LV endastolic pressure, or we need to calculate a lot of hemodynamics, we always put an arterial line. Do not compromise on putting an arterial line. The obstructive lesions, of course, the gradients and the ventricular pressures. We'll go one by one. The ASD is a very common topic. Dr. Bharat told me that respect the rims. But I would say, except in most of the cases, in some situation, respect the hemodynamics. That is very, very important. The PA systolic pressure may not be necessary in each and every child. For example, you have a 10-year-old child with a standard simple AST with a 13 or 14 millimeter AST where you don't find any high PA pressure. You don't have to really calculate, but it is mandatory to calculate in some most of the other situations. Systolic blood pressure, I did already mention to you. QPBQS, we don't routinely do it because most of the decision we have already taken on the echocardiography whether to close that particular AST or not. The PVR in certain selected patients. I'll come to that. The LVEDP, it's a very neglected entity, but somewhere along the way, we land up in trouble if we do not give much importance to the LV endastolic pressure, especially when you are closing a AST with a slightly higher age group or a severe systemic hypertension. The post-occlusion hemodynamics, there's so many, there is no, once again, there is no consensus on some of the, most of these things, whether to close in some borderline ASTs or not. There's no consensus on that. But what we have found, what most of us have found, in an AST and a PDA is a post-occlusion. What happens if you occlude the AST or a PDA following the occlusion temporarily, 5 minutes or 10 minutes, after the routine data like oximetry, PA pressure, PVR calculation, everything. This is definitely, according to us, this is going to give us some clue whether to back out from that particular closing AST or not. The case one, a 50-year-old female, class 2 symptoms, non-hypertensive, non-diabetic, a large secondary AST, a trivial pulmonary artery pressure is 50. So I think I would say the most of the elderly people, like more than 40 years of age, just make an, it takes about 30 seconds to calculate the PA pressure. This is incomplete RBBB, axis is 90, this is a very standard AST. This is the X-ray, this is cardiomegaly, plethoric lung fields. This is the standard 38 millimeter AST. Probably suitable. But she is 50 plus, the PA pressure is 50 in the cath, so we occlude it with a balloon and see what happens. So this is, on the, you could see the PA pressure is 62, it's slightly more than what we calculate on the echocardiography, sometimes it happens. But here it looks like it's one third of the systemic, please do not go by that. In a AST, it behaves differently from a VST. The AST, even a 50 or 60 millimeters of mercury, is slightly more hypertensive. For example, you have a VST with the PA pressure around 50 or 60, the systemic pressure is 100. That means you have a half systemic. Still, clearly, they are operable, but does not hold good for a AST. Please remember that. Please give much, very, very importance to the pulmonary arterial, irrespective of the pressure if it is more than 45 or 50. So what happens after the balloon occlusion? It has dropped. There's no, once again, there's nothing like how much, how many minutes we need to stop, how many minutes we need to occlude it. But if it starts dropping at least 20 or 30%, at least minimum 30% it has to drop, that means that probably that particular AST is suitable either for surgical or otherwise. The LVEDP here, it did rise to 16, but we need to wait for that. It has happened many times when the LVEDP has gone up, they've gone into pulmonary edema. So second lady, 56-year-old, similar thing, PF pressure is 40. This is a very standard. ECG is not giving any clue that not much of RV strain. This is the X-ray. This is anybody who would have gone and done the closure of this AST, because it looks like a very garden variety of the simple, moderately large AST, left-right, predominantly left-right shunt. PA pressure 43. So this is the pressure tracing. This is the pre-procedural, pre-balloon occlusion, PA pressure 40. I occluded for 5 to 10 minutes. It went up to 60 millimeters of mercury. LVEDP also went up. So I backed out in this particular case. So it is not that every moderately large VST is clearly predominantly left right. Once again, the oximetry, there has to be a step up in all these large ASTs, irrespective of the PVR, irrespective of the PA pressure. There will be a step up. Please do not go with the step up. So give a lot of importance to the hemodynamics, especially the PA, arterial systolic pressure, and the LVEDP. Case 3, here you see a lot of strain. You could see in the ECG, monophasic R. This is the X-ray. This is a large AST. It looks a bit bidirectional on the echo. And one more thing, in the echo, please give importance to the IVC imaging. It gives us some idea about the RV endostolic pressure and RV function. If the RV endostolic pressure is very high, the IVC will be dilated, non-collapsing. That means we are dealing here with a case with the RV dysfunction. Here, I do not think that we'll be able to close this ASP. So here, it drops to some extent, but still we are not very happy. This is another thing. It is nothing related to the closure of the AST. You have a saturation is 87%, 25-year-old lady, 20 millimeter AST, standard AST. This is ECG. What you notice here, outside diagnosis, a large VST, but you don't find any RV forces here. The RV activity is not there in the V1. So this is not running. The RV is small. There is a large AST which is showing bidirectional. For a AST of a 20 millimeter AST, we cannot accept this amount of the RV. RV has to be dilated. So that means we are dealing with probably a hyperplastic tricuspid annulus and a small RV. You close, go and close the AST, then definitely RV will start failing. These are not suitable for a two ventricular repair. In fact, what they have diagnosed as a large VST was probably a closing down VST with multiple VST she has had. So this is the cath data. Aortic saturation is 92%. PA pressure is 30. So that means a normal PA pressure. So there is a mild systemic desaturation. Because RV is small, ASD is moderately large, we cannot close, we should not close. The PDA, come to PDA. We do see a lot of PDAs in an elderly age group. What is most important in a PDA is that we would have made some judgment on this, how whether to close or not. You see here, LA and LV are dilated. The shunting is predominantly left to right. The peak pressure is 32. That means it's a slightly subsystemic. Cath data is like this. PA pressure, you see. But here, we were quite sure the normal saturation, not much of desaturation in the lower limbs. We occluded this particular PDA with a very, very large device. The PA pressure dropped significantly to 30 millimeters of mercury during the 40 millimeters during the follow. AP window, we did not come across normally. Most of the AP windows are large, very few. Go to the adulthood, they're all restrictive AP windows. Large AP windows, by and large, after 6 months or 1 year, they become inoperable. So very rarely, moderately large AP windows, measuring up to 12 millimeter, we do come across, even in these situations, even it is you find a subsystemic PA pressure, but we need to see the hemodynamics and probably occlude the balloon and see what happens. Here we did close with this device closure. This is the pre-procedure. This is the AP window. Used a perimembranous device, and we closed it, the PA pressure dropped. This is one of the very rare case. We have backed out recently one 9-year-old girl, non-restrictive AP window, easily suitable, but as soon as I put a device, though it was a subsystemic 20 millimeters mercury, LA and LV are dilated, we had to back out because the moment we put a device, the pressure started dropping, a lot of bradycardia. Probably it was causing some kind of a problem on the above the aortic sinus. So here, we did a mistake in the sense that we have assessed, we went by the mildly dilated LALV, we did not use a balloon, but we historically put a device, but it did not drop. The PA pressure did not drop. Not only that, aortic pressure also dropped. The PA pressure went remained at the same time. The most important, the moment if it is an operable PDA, the PA pressure should come down. There has to be a wide separation. Aortic pressure should increase. If it does not happen by 40% or 35 to 40%, we should not close the PDA because we might get away with that initially, but in the long run, all these people probably will develop RV dysfunction. So make sure that the PA pressure at least should drop by 40%, ideally 50%, at least 40% should drop. The VST, it's not very common backward because we would have made some already decision whether to close or not. Most of them peri-membranous VSTs, either restrictive VSTs, we have made some decision. We don't come across this kind of a backing out of from this. Here is a large VST muscular. We do come across very rarely. Here we cannot balloon occlude, obviously, because we don't do that. So here we have to go by the standard calculation of the PVR. If it does not drop to 3 or 4, we have no right to close these VSTs. Very rare case I'm going to go. We have backed out an RSOV in some case. This is a simple RSOV to RVOT, slightly older age group, 25-30. So we were measuring some kind of a band, or we were probably mistaking for a RVOT gradient. But when we did a cath, RV pressure was 60. That means we have to put a device in the RVOT, close it. Then already the RV, there is a gradient of 35 millimeter, 30 millimeters of mercury across the RVOT. You put a device, it is going to increase. So we backed out, we sent it for surgery. Coming to the obstructive lesions, this is a child, this is not a much of a backing out. A child arrested on the table, I mean shifted from the casualty. So during the manipulation divide in the RV, it arrested bradycardia. So there was an arterial line, so I went and put a, just to tide over the crisis, PDA stenting was done. But post-stenting, after 2 days, I did a balloon valvuloplasty. But you see the result here, we have not got a good result. RV still post is 120. That means we are not dealing with a very standard garden variety of a pulmonary stenosis. Here probably the pulmonary annulus was small, hypoplastic annulus. So we need to come out, we need to tell the parents that this particular patient, though we have done a balloon valvuloplasty, this is only a palliation. All these children have to go for a final procedures, like a surgical procedure like a valvotomy and augmentation of the annulus. Very rarely we do come across some of the pre-Fontan. Here, a Glenn shunt was done in a child 3 years of age, 4 years back, the PA pressure. Certainly this amount of 19 mm of mercury of the peak mean is not suitable for a completion of Fontan. So what next? Saturation is 90. So we all of us have done, even Shiva has done, most of us have done that. We try to close the antegrade valve. There is a lot of antegrade flow with a device to reduce the pressure. You block off the antegrade flow. What happens to the pressure? Okay. The PA pressure drop, but it does not mean that these children are going to be suitable for Fontan. What is important is not a PA pressure alone here. You need to calculate the PVR. This child is on a follow-up. The coarctation is another thing that a lot of times we need to do some kind of a cosmetic dilatation in the cosmetic angioplasty that has to be curtailed. So a 20-year-old man post-aortoplasty was done surgically. Aortic valve replacement was at the age of 17 years of age. Severe AS, echocardiography because it's moderate AS, sorry. And coarctation was, gradient was measuring around 50 plus. So this is the angiography. So we did not cross the aortic valve. We did a transeptal puncture. Because every time we used to come with multiple complaints, echocardiography was showing 50 to 60 gradient. So we wanted to have a proper dynamics. Do all that. It's very important. Doing a transeptal puncture, enter the LV, and then check the gradient. This is the gradient, this is the hemodynamic data on the cath table. The LV 150, Essinger-Guyot 130, Essinger-Guyot 130. We have a gradient of only 25 millimeters of mercury, so across the coarctate segment. So we don't have to do the balloon dilatation here because it's not really needed in this particular case. Like that, so we do have to check the hemodynamics before resorting to any kind of intervention. Here, once again, VSD closure some time ago. Echo gradient was exaggerates. Please remember, echo gradient exaggerates in a coarctation because of tachycardia, anemia, multiple factors. So the hemodynamic, sometime it will help you in making your decision. So this is not a suitable. Please remember the coarctation in infants and neonates. The balloon dilatation is not the treatment of choice. Most important is the surgical repair is the treatment of choice. But sometimes we are pushed to the wall in severe LV dysfunction as a palliative measure. So this is one where we have done with the balloon dilatation. Not good result. Post-dilatation also 30. So this just stabilized the child and sent for surgery. Because you see the hypoplastic The transverse arch. So this is one very severe relative dysfunction, almost near arrest state came, we stabilized, and we took it for the quad dilatation as a palliative measure with a balloon. But post-balloon dilatation, we didn't get it. This happens many times in a neonatal or infantile dilatation, that we can put a stent in those. We need to change our decision for just plain balloon angioplasty to the stenting. So I know it's an undersized stent, but our idea is it's not a permanent procedure. It's a palliative procedure. So see the gradient. It is decreased. So we can always electively plan the surgical procedure. This is another boy. This is a gradient of 38 or 40 echocardiographically. You see, angiographically, it looks quite a significant coarctation. Hmm? But this is the gradient. This is done recently.
Dr. Ranganath, the cases are fantastic and your presentation is wonderful.
Detailed hemodynamics is necessary in a borderline lesions. When in doubt, do not proceed with the interventions. Do not convert Eisenmenger physiology into the PPH, especially in the ASD and a PDA. Cosmetic angioplasty should be avoided as far as possible. Thank you.